Welcome to episode 10 of Where Are They Now? I'm your host and broadcaster with the Ottawa Junior Senators, Davide DiCipio. Tonight on the podcast, I'm pleased to be joined by four-year vet of the Ottawa Junior Senators and four-year vet in the NCAA Division I at Rochester Institute of Technology, Ian Andriano. Ian, we bid you hello and welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
All right, Ian, let's go way back to a young yourself in Barrie, Ontario. Where did it all start for you playing hockey?
I just started playing hockey when I was about four. Southern Ontario is a big Leafs fan. I know that probably hurts a lot of Ottawa faithful, but so I grew up watching the Leafs and Curtis Joseph, Matt Sundin, Darcy Tucker, guys like that. So I always loved hockey and I always wanted to be a goalie. Cujo was huge for me. I loved him growing up and so I started playing goalie when I was six and, worked my way up through there and then was lucky enough to go to a great organization in Ottawa and another great organization with RIT.
And now leading into, of course, your older years, transitioning when you're set to make your decision to go, whether it's the Ontario Hockey League route or go the NCAA route, usually kids have their mind made up when they're about 15 years old. But when did it that decision for you come to say, I want to go with the NCAA route and the CCHL was the best option?
Well, I actually had my mind made up. I wanted to play in the OHL. Growing up in Barrie, I wanted to play for the Colts, like probably any kid that grew up in Barrie. And, that was a big deal around town. And then draft day came around and my name wasn't called. And so I didn't really know what to do. It felt at, 15, like it was the end of the road for me, which clearly it wasn't. And I was lucky enough to play another year midget, get to Ottawa and really learn a lot about the NCAA route and that it would be a good route for me to take. I didn't know much about it growing up until, the O closed its doors on me a little bit and I had to look elsewhere.
And we speak on the decision to join Ottawa. Speak of who was the first person to reach out to you from the organization and what drew you to the team and to the city.
So it was Rick Dorval was the coach at the time. He invited me down to skate with the team during their just the end of their regular season run. I believe they won the league that year. They had a really good team. I went out to a practice, watched a game, got a feel for it. They needed a goalie the next year. I got invited to camp and came down and ended up staying there. And it was one of the best hockey decisions I've ever made. But yeah, it was really cool to see, I believe it was a playoff game that I watched and, for a smaller rink, there's kind of packed it. And it was really interesting to see all the fans and how kind of hockey works and at the next level with the practice that I got to experience skating with them. So,
and you mentioned when you come to Ottawa for years at the time, what was the biggest transition for you coming from relatively suburb of a big city in Toronto, coming to not so big of a city, but still a pretty big city in Ottawa?
Yeah, I didn't know much about Ottawa when I came at 17. So I was actually living out in Gloucester with my first billet family, going to Lester B. Pearson High School in grade 12. I didn't know much about anything. Like I didn't realize that I was actually closer to, because Gloucester was still in the league back then. I was actually closer to their rink than our home rink. Just, I didn't realize kind of how the city worked and how there's, Gloucester, Navin, all the suburbs like Nepean and stuff. So that was a big adjustment with school. And just learned to live kind of without my parents, at a young age, first time. I mean, it's only a year before most people move out for the first time, but that's a big step for any kid. And I felt like I learned a lot during that experience, which, I went back home, that first summer and realized, I had to work harder and I had to make better decisions, in eating habits and working out and stuff, to be effective at the level. Cause I didn't have the best rookie year. And I came back and had a better second year and that really taught me a lot. And it was a very valuable learning experience.
who did you lead on off the ice and on the ice? Of course, goalie partners always play a big factor in a young goaltender like yourself at the time's development. But who are some of the guys that you lean to really get a grasp of junior hockey and hockey at the next level from what you're used to in minor hockey?
Alex Savard Belanger was my goalie partner for my first 2 years when I was 17 and 18. And I couldn't be more thankful to him for a lot of that stuff. I mean, just learning kind of how to prepare day in and day out and what the caliber of hockey was and what being a high quality goaltender at the junior A level really looked like. He was awesome. Steph, our goalie coach there, that he still works with the team. He was great. I still talk to him. Now, I mean, every time I win a game, I get a text from Steph saying, "Oh, I'm so glad to see you in there and playing." So, those two for sure were huge in my development.
And you say you didn't have the best of 17-year-old your first year in junior at 7-5 you went, but then you go 13-5 as an 18-year-old. So would you say that your off-season planning from year one to year two, even you decided to take that next step and become even better going into your 19-year-old year?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's really a text I got because I don't know if Martin would remember this, but I remember we changed coaches, obviously, and Martin took over and I texted him, you know, when that change happened and he kind of said, you know, like, you got to come to camp and earn your spot because, you know, nothing's guaranteed. And that kind of woke me up a little bit. And I was like, okay, you know, I don't want to be looking for a spot to play. I like it here. And so I went to work and, you know, yeah, we had a great plan going forward. I mean, Martin gave me some opportunities when I was playing well. I remember I played against CP that year and got a win early on, which was huge for my confidence. Got to play a lot more consistently, you know, obviously not starter minutes, but I was able to, you know, play the second half of back-to-backs or one in every three, which I played a lot more games, which helped me mature as a goaltender and become, get better at playing at that level and be able to take on more responsibility.
And do you feel like that fire that Martin put under you really helped you and excelled as one of the top net miners in the CCHL when you doubled your games played in your 19 and 20 year old year?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's the same thing, right? Cause that text stays with you, right? When you're not quite sure what's going to happen. So yeah, I know I had a pretty good 18-year-old year, and then I didn't know whether they were going to try to get a more experienced guy to maybe do more of like a tandem type thing or if he was going to give me the reins. So I just, you know, obviously I wanted as many minutes as he was going to allow me to play. So I went home and did the same thing, worked really hard and came back. We had a really good team and, you know, we went on a bit of a run there.
Yeah, and you mentioned, let's jump to your 20-year-old year was really when all the accolades started to come for you. Of course, you win the team MVP in your 16-17 season after going 32-12-1, couple of shutouts in that year for you as well. Many player of the week honors, a goaltender of the month thrown in there as well, but really just showed for how much the team came together on your the way to the Bogart Cup finals in your final year of junior. And what was all working for you in your final year of junior leading up to your commitment?
Honestly, it was just kind of, I decided to go play. I think I struggled a little bit early on because I was, you know, pretty focused on trying to get a commitment, and maybe I was thinking a little too much and trying to do a little more than I should have. But, you know, at some point I just went out and had fun, and we had a great team and a great group of guys. We were really close all 4 years we were really close, but both my 19 and 20 year old year was, you know, some of the most tight-knit groups we had. And you know, we just had fun and we had a great team. And I all just kind of went in, and I had a lot of confidence after, you know, I'd go on and play a couple good games, and we just we were rolling at certain points, and it was fun. It was one of the most fun years I had playing hockey. So
you were named the team in team awards. You were the recipient of two straight most dedicated players awards, and you ranked since 1990, you ranked second in the Ottawa Junior Senators organization in terms of games played. So when you look at your junior career from a 17-year-old yourself to a 20-year-old yourself, do you feel like the message of I have to come in and earn my spot really progressed you into the elite goaltender that you became?
Absolutely. I think, you know, growing up, I never really had the fast track for anything. I never really played AAA until my Bantam year. So, yeah, I knew I kind of had to work for everything. And again, some of the things we talked about, you know, kicked me in the butt, and I had to wake up and work hard. And that's something I take pride in. I mean, those two awards mean a lot to me, because it's voted on by the team. And that really means a lot that I had that kind of respect from my teammates. And yeah, so it helped a lot for sure.
And you commit to the Rochester Institute of Technology, where you ultimately now wrap up your four-year NCAA career. What led into that decision, and who were some of the driving factors to say, hey, that's where I want to spend the next 4 years of my career?
I got down to campus when I was 20 for a visit, and we watched a game. We watched RIT play Army, and the atmosphere of the school was unbelievable. It was off the charts. I mean, the facilities are great. Coaches are great. Really, just really nice people. And, you know, everywhere I turned, everybody had good things to say. I mean, Martin was really helpful, putting me in touch with the coaches and stuff. And, you know, I just first class facilities, first class coaches. And I was really excited to be able to continue my hockey career.
Zach Salum, who was a member of RIT for a couple of seasons, spent half a year with the Ottawa Junior Senators en route to the team's first Bogart Cup. And was it nice in the locker room to have that OJS connection? I know I mentioned it with some of the St. Lawrence guys that they have that connection, but was it nice in a different locker room to have that tie to the Junior Sens organization?
Absolutely. Me and Zach played against each other. I think he played an extra year, but his first 4 years we played against each other when he was playing with Gloucester and then Navin. And yeah, it was really nice to have somebody. And I was really happy for the team and him, you know, because he came in the year after we finally broke through. I mean, I, of course, would have rather it happened during my time there. But yeah, I was really happy for the team at that point. It was nice to be able to kind of relive those moments vicariously through him when he was here.
And going into your sophomore year, your freshman year at RIT, what was the biggest transition for you from junior hockey going in to NCAA Division I hockey? Because, of course, more of a condensed schedule, balancing more academics and on the ice in terms of practice and games. But especially as a goaltender, you're playing way less games than you would have played in junior. But how was the transition for you?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing was my realization that I wasn't just going to get a chance. I wasn't one of two goalies. I was now one of three. So you kind of had to earn any net you were going to get, and any little time could be the turning point for you, where you could get an opportunity or lose an opportunity. I mean, you know, I went in relief a couple of times my freshman year and didn't perform so great. And, you know, that probably cost me starts that maybe I could have gotten if I had done a little better in those times. I mean, the pace is faster. Everybody can shoot. Everybody can score at the next level compared to, you know, junior. It was the same feeling I had when I was 17 coming into OJS. So, yeah, I mean, you just got to compete way more, because there's only 34 games, maybe 36 if you play in a tournament and then playoffs, and every game means so much. You play 26 in conference games and it all matters. There's only so many buys and whatnot to get into playoffs, and every game matters out of conference for maybe trying to get a bid to the NCAA. So there's no nights where a coach is just going to give you a start to try to see what you got. You got to prove it in practice every day and prove it when you do get in, and yeah, there's less room for error for sure.
One of the most interesting things I find, especially with goaltenders and the NCAA division, well, NCAA hockey in general, is dressing three goaltenders. And how was it different for you at first coming into your freshman year dressing when you're probably not going to see the ice, even though there's a guy in front of you on the food chain? But take me through that whole process of what it's like to see goaltenders on both sides of the bench when you're playing in the starter's net.
Yeah, it's kind of second nature for me now after 4 years. But yeah, coming in was weird. I mean, the biggest thing was practices. I think you're like, oh, okay, I'm not gonna get the net, you know, 50% of the time. I gotta wait and maybe, you know, the other guy's starting, so he gets more reps, so you get even less because of that. But yeah, it's an interesting dynamic in warm up how you know the starter gets whatever he wants, and then you're almost trying to get a shot or two in there in the game warm up and whatnot. And but yeah, it's kind of second nature to me now.
So walk me through your first game, or your first win in the NCAA came courtesy of a shutout against Canisius. And what do you remember most about that special night for you?
Not much, honestly. I got a start the night before and we lost in overtime, and then I didn't really, it was pretty late in the season, so I didn't know if I was going to be playing, and I got the start. And then, yeah, we played really well. I don't think we gave up that many shots. So it was really cool to get it all wrapped up into one there. But yeah, not much. We played a really good game, and that's a special memory for me.
So for three of the last 4 years at RIT, you've been named to the conference's All-Academic Honor Roll team. So how important has it been for you to balance both on the ice success as well as academic success and academic success?
It's been really important, and we take pride in that at RIT a lot. We always talk about it that our athletic GPA is higher than the cumulative student body's GPA, which is a real point of emphasis for us here at RIT. And yeah, I mean, it's I came here to play hockey, obviously, but to be able to get a really good education and to have the opportunity and the support from athletics to do that, you know, allowing us extra time and extra resources and whatever we needed to get our schoolwork done, and understanding when, you know, if we have a class that conflicts with something, you know, teachers have been great at helping us accommodate that type of stuff. So yeah, it's huge.
Take me through this year in particular. Of course, you were I would say few schools, but there's some schools that didn't play hockey at all this past year. Mm-hmm. But RIT was one that did get to play games. And just walk me through the entire season in terms of testing and all the protocols that were put into place, and traveling, of course, out of conference games, and walk me through the COVID season.
Yeah. So it was a real roller coaster for us. Our season actually was briefly canceled by our administration early on, and we kind of fought to have it back because RIT is a Division I hockey program for both the men's and women's, but we have the rest of our athletics is Division III. So the Division III leagues canceled their seasons and our league had not, and our administration kind of took a blanket approach at that point and canceled us as well. And we laid out a plan that said, you know, we don't think we should be canceled. We have a season, we have protocols that we can go through. There's other teams doing this. And we hadn't had a positive test up to that point, which was, you know, almost at the end of the first semester when this happened. So we'd proven that we were serious about it, but yeah, it was totally different. I mean, testing three times a week, we'd gone through our bouts of quarantines and 10 days off here and 10 days off there. And then you get back and you ramp up and you're getting ready for a game and the game gets canceled because somewhere along the line, there's a COVID protocol that the game has to get canceled. So it was different, but yeah, we wore masks on the ice except for games, and we wore masks working out and masks everywhere, and yeah, testing three times a week. And it was interesting.
All right, Ian, as we get towards the end here, I want to get turn this the time over to you, and I want you to reflect on your last on the 4 years that you had with the Ottawa Junior Senators organization, whether it's stories from Marty, Steph, even your brief interactions with Rose before going out onto the ice before periods. If you want to expose anybody in a funny story at this point of the podcast, I turn it over to you, and a little story time from your time with OJS.
Well, Rose was the best, and yeah, I would always, I was a guy that would go out a little early, you know. I like to get away from all the noise in the dressing room before games and just get out in the hallway and kind of kind of go over what I wanted to do in the game and thinking Rose is always out there, just so excited. So she's awesome. She is exactly what junior hockey is all about. Always love seeing her at the rink and seeing her after games, and she was our biggest fan. So that's awesome. No, I don't really have any stories to expose anybody, but I would like to thank everybody in the Ottawa Junior Centers organization. I mean, they're first class through and through, from Marty all the way down to, you know, Rose and people that do the tickets and whatnot. And my billets, I was lucky enough to have three different billet families, and they were all awesome. So I'd like to thank them if they end up watching this, and thank my parents, my family, and support me all 3 years. And I had some family out in Ottawa that I'd like to thank for coming to all my games when it was a little bit difficult living 5 hours away from home at 17 and, you know, making it home away from home.
And I got reading up on your bio on the RIT website, dream job as a sports broadcaster. Now, are we talking hockey sports broadcasting in specific, or what sport would Ian Andriano specialty in?
Yeah, probably hockey. I don't know if that's going to happen. I think my dream job's maybe changed a bit over the last 4 years now, but I can't think of a better way to make a living than following a sport. I think the new dream job might be hosting a podcast, you know, and I can just watch hockey and talk about it and interview some players and stuff and make it a little more free flowing, kind of like Spittin' Chicklets has done. I mean, I'm sure everybody you've talked to listens to that. I'm sure you do as well. Yeah, I think that might be the new one. But if it was a sport other than hockey, it would have to be baseball or golf. Don't know enough about golf probably to do. I enjoy playing it, but baseball, that was my second sport growing up. So I'd love to do baseball.
And of course, baseball, mental aspect to the game. Of course, you might want to keep, or as a goaltender, I never played goalie, but as a goaltender, do you sense that the strategic part of the game really kicks in when you're in between the pipes?
Yeah, I guess. I don't know. I try not to think too much when I play. I just kind of try to let the action happen. When I think too much, bad things happen. They don't need me thinking out there. So I just kind of let it happen and react.
Fair enough. All right, Ian, congratulations on your four-year career at RIT. Thank you for all that you did for the Ottawa Junior Senators organization. Best of luck in your academics going forward, and we'll catch up with you down the line.
Thanks so much for having me. I appreciate it.